So thank you so much. It's great to be home and back in Canada with the snow feels different here. It's the snow of my childhood walking to high school. It feels differently under your feet. The Americans just don't know how to get snow correct. They, no matter how long I live there, they can't figure out what to do. And I want to thank, obviously, the center here for this very warm invitation. It's really amazing what University of Toronto has been able to do, not only in the field of Jewish studies in general, but also in the field of Yiddish. And of course, that has to do in no small measure with the work of Anna and her colleagues and the wonderful graduate students that I was able to spend time with in Tel Aviv last summer. And it's also wonderful to be someone speaking about Yiddish to an audience. Because although there's a lot of young Yiddish scholars now, you'd be surprised where you could go. Some very big name universities in the world where you go and the audiences are much smaller than what you might expect. But in Toronto, this is my second time here in recent years, there's always a lovely and warm crowd. And when I was here a few years ago, I think in 2015, I gave sort of an overview of this group of writers that I'm working on, the group of writers known as Jung Vilna. And in light of the fact that some people might have been at that lecture, and I didn't want to repeat myself, I thought I would do something a little different today, related to those writers and, of course, related to the city of Vilna, but talking a little bit about the development of Vilna in Yiddish poetry, not in prose, and why there seemed to be an interest in this and why it's so important to think of literary centers. But before we do that, the title. When Yiddish was young, and all of you should have a handout. If not, I hope there's others. There's nothing else. This is just a tease. There's nothing else being shown on these, so you don't need to look at these at all. When I was talking with my publisher about what I wanted to call my book, I immediately said, I'll call my book When Yiddish Was Young. And the publisher said, no, you can't call your book that. It'll never sell. You have to call it something else. But I still call it, you know, in my own mind, When Yiddish Was Young, because those of us who entered the field of Yiddish in the late 80s or early 90s know that there's a paradox in Yiddish studies, that Yiddish, at least in the popular imagination, perhaps not among those who know Yiddish, like you, but those who think they know about Yiddish, that Yiddish is something that belongs to the past, right? A curiosity, something that's old, something that belongs to history, and that Hebrew, in some ways, belongs to the present and to the future. And of course, this was not always the case. There was a time when Hebrew struggled to emerge from the burden of its own history and its own religiosity, and Yiddish was accused of only having contemporaneity and of lacking any sense of a classical tradition. So when I talk about when Yiddish was young and try to introduce that as a concept, I really mean three things for the purposes of today's discussion. One is cultural, right? That in the absence of rabbinic authority to hold this people together, culture would now have to define the Jews, secular culture. And Yiddish would be, or Yiddishists wanted to propose, that Yiddish ought to be a core component of the modern Jewish nation in its humanist, in its secular, in its modern incarnations. It should be its address. It should be its expression. It should be its values. How would Yiddish bring the Jew into conversation with broader trends in world art, world culture? The second, if culture is one aspect of that, the second is generational. When Jewish experience is lived in Yiddish, it's lived from cradle to grave. Obviously, it's not only lived by grandparents. Nowadays, people think, oh, it's the language of grandparents or of great-grandparents. Well, in the period that I'm writing about, it's the language of daycares. It's the language of sports groups. It's the language of choirs. It's the language of schooling. It's the language of lovemaking. It's the language of everything from cradle to grave. And we need to reconceptualize our understanding of what Yiddish is if we're really going to be able to communicate this into the next generation once perhaps the generation or the second generation of those for whom secular Yiddish culture was their birthright, their inheritance, is no longer around. And the third aspect of this idea of when Yiddish was young is artistic, right? When Yiddish is young also corresponds, in my argument, to what we might call the Yiddish modernist moment. That is the explosion or the move from Yiddish realism to Yiddish high modernism. in all of its different experimental and radical incarnations. And that really begins, people date it differently, but it really begins in the period just before or during or immediately after World War I, marked perhaps in Poland best by the lines of the Chaliastre, who famously said at one point, "We, the young, a happy, boisterous gang, off on unknown roads." This smacked of unrefined defiance and of rootlessness. And for those of us who know anything about Jews, one of the things that historically Jews feared the most was chaos and a lack of authority, a lack of borders and boundaries and laws and understandings. This idea that you would have a young group of Jews who thought to define the Jewish future based on not having roots and of being totally defiant, of being boisterous, of rejecting any previous authority was almost unheard of. And this joined a broader international modernist movement that also was rejecting overarching authorities. The other aspect of this idea of when Yiddish was young, the second part, Vilna's last generation, is obviously something I've been thinking about with centering and decentering. I have the privilege of teaching at a liberal arts college and teaching at a women's only liberal arts college. So most of my life is only teaching women. And of course, in this generation, many of them are interested in topics of decentering, right? What's in vogue now is decentering. What's in vogue now is marginality and marginalizations. But I think that before you can actually have a conversation about decentering and marginality, you actually have to understand why centers matter, what centers do, and why people react against them or try to redefine them. So in some ways, what we're talking about today is a combination of this group of writers that I'm talking about, this group of writers known as Jung Vilna, as Young Vilna, that are defined both by generation, by youth, and also by place. The first song that I have on the handout might be very familiar to those of you who know something of Yiddish song, or at least the city of Vilna. This is a song, I'm not going to dare sing it properly, but how many people know this song? The famous, can anyone sing it for me? Or can you sing it collectively if I ask you to? Yeah. A little bit, you can. Collectively. Okay, so if I go 1, 2, 3, you can sing it. And then I'll talk about it. And you can follow along if you don't know the tune. All right, go for it. Start. Unser. They could use them. So we'll start from the beginning. Vilna Stadt von Geist und Tmimes, Vilna Yiddish Lech Vatracht, wo es murmeln, stielet vieles, stielet soides von der Nacht. Oftmal seh ich dir in Cholum, heiß geliebte Vilna mein und die alte Vilner Ghetto in a Nepaldike Schein. Now your refrain. Vilna, Vilna, unser Heimstadt, unser Bankschaft und Bagger. Ach, wie oft es ruft dein Namen von mein Neufaräuser Trär. Vilna Gesslech, Vilna Teichen, Vilna Werder Barg und Toll. Eppes Neuet, Eppes Bank sich noch die Zeiten von Amol. So there's another stanza, but we won't go through the whole thing. Though not a literary masterpiece by any means, this song, published, written by Wolfson in 1934, represents a common trope of poetic writing about Vilna that embraces many of its core elements. First, the combination of Vilna as both a real place and a dream world, right? So it actually points out specific places in Vilna, the old Vilna ghetto in its foggy glow. But this idea of there's a contradiction there. How can you have a foggy glow? Either something glows or something's foggy. So there's a glow through the fog. How does fog glow? It's both murky, perhaps, maybe it's the stuff of dreams, but also a source of great inspiration. The song also references the dual legacies of Vilna, that of being traditional and modern, religious and political. It speaks of the old Vilna ghetto, of prayer, of the flag of freedom, on the other hand, of the Bund, of territorialism, of communism, of Zionism. It's brave. It's vague enough in how it sort of articulates this to embrace all of those things. It also suggests a particular Jewish conceptualization of physical space, right? If you think of this, Vilna Yiddishlich vertracht, right? Jewishly conceived or perhaps absorbed in thinking about things Jewish or things Yiddish. Either way, it lays claim to perhaps an exclusive Jewish claim over Vilna as both a physical space and as a cultural capital. and as a capital of Yiddish diaspora nationalism. So this idea of possession of place. We've seen this before when Dan Miron taught us about Sholem Aleichem and how Sholem Aleichem wrote about the shtetl. He was very specific in telling us that the shtetl of Sholem Aleichem is nothing like the real shtetl because Sholem Aleichem goes to great efforts to write non-Jews out of the shtetl. And in some ways, this poem writes non-Jews out of Vilna, even though we know that Vilna was the most multicultural of the great Jewish centers of the interwar period, right? Because we have here a center that's about 30% Jewish, 30% Polish, then Lithuanian, Belarusian, some German. So where are all these other people mentioned in this song? The descriptive evocation of place, the refrain of Geslich, Teichen, Velder, Bar, Guntol. Any of you who've gone to Vilna know that this is the reality of the city, the geography of cultural space. And also lastly, Vilna as something that is inherited, something that's passed down from one generation to another. But also, even by the time of 1934, here's the paradox. It's 1934 when Vilna ostensibly is at the height of its power, right? It is the interwar capital of Yiddishland. It is the center of YIVO. It is one of the only Yiddish high schools in Poland. Warsaw can't support a Yiddish-speaking high school with many more times the population, but Vilna can. Yet already here we have this idea that it's a place of loss, a place of longing, perhaps even a dreamscape. So we have one of the great sentimental contributions to the Yiddish song repertoire here, up there with Bells, Mein Shtetle Bells, perhaps, with its own interesting cultural trajectory. Because this was a poem that became a song, originally commissioned for the Vilna Sammelbuch, published in Yiddish in 1935 by the Workman's Circle in New York. That is, it is an immigrant text. It's not a Vilna text. It's a text written by people from Vilna about their memories. That is, it's a text of cultural nostalgia and of reconstruction. The song, however, has its own history after that. It makes its way back to Vilna in the mid to late 1930s, becoming very popular locally there with Vilna natives who see themselves under tremendous economic and political threat. And then it becomes, in a way, the unofficial anthem of Vilna Jewry. So think of this. You have someone who leaves Vilna for a better life, you know, in the United States, writes a song, a sentimental song about Vilna. The song goes back over the ocean to become something that becomes the pride, the singing pride of its own community. And then it becomes the song at which many, many events in the Vilna ghetto opens with. So you have this song in a really, really interesting way circulating. It's a local anthem composed by a child who abandons it, and then, nonetheless, a city that then reclaims it. Now, why is it that some cities elicit rather slim poetic attention, whereas others seem to encourage constant revisiting? Or more specifically, how was the image of Vilna crafted, especially in the interwar period, by its native poets in such a way as to produce an image of the city as the cultural capital of Yiddishland? And part of this has to do with the idea that's invented in this period of Nusach Vilna. So many of us might be familiar with the concept of Nusach from the way you chant sort of prayer, cantillate something, sort of a version, a way of doing something. But Nusach Vilna here really means the Vilna style, the Vilna way. Traditionally, we might think of this as a method, very often associated with music. But can a city also have its own Nusach, right? If I said, what is the Toronto Nusach? And how does it differ from the Montreal Nusach? Would we be able to define those things? How would we be able to provide words to them if I asked you, write a poem about Jewish Montreal, write a poem about Jewish Toronto, and tell me what the nusach of each is each and capture that in the poem? It sounds better, but it's much more difficult than it actually sounds. So in order to appreciate the image of Vilna in Yiddish poetry, we first have to rehearse certain things that distinguish Vilna from other Eastern European Jewish centers of the interwar period. And then we can concentrate in the next part of the lecture on several texts that I've brought. And we will explore three different types of texts in the second part of the discussion today. One, the poetic myth of Vilna as it's established in modern Jewish poetry. In the period of the 1920s, that's interested in the questions that I've just raised, possession of place, built landscape, natural landscape, human landscape, cultural landscape, doikite, diaspora nationalism, one type of text. The The second text will be counter texts, really counter myths of the 1930s that respond to the reality of the street and that are advanced by members of Jung Vilna. We might think of these as parodies of Vilna, parodic texts or radical texts. And finally, we'll look at Vilna and the landscape of memory, texts written either in the Vilna ghetto or in the immediate aftermath of it, and how all of these things now form sort of part of a library of local civilization. In the short time accorded to me today, I'm not going to talk about prose at all. And I know that for many of you avid readers, and I'm among them, you know, you could look at Yosef Bulov's From That Old Marketplace, Chaim Grada's Mamas Shabbosim and Rabbis and Wives, and Der Schulhof, Avram Karpinovich's Av Vilner Gassen, Av Vilner Wegen, beim Vilner Durachhof, and a lot more. But today we're going to stick to poetry. So a little bit about the context. My colleague, really the greatest thinker in terms of defining Vilna and comparing it to Warsaw, is Sam Casso, who sort of just down the road from where I teach, about half an hour. And even he, in one of his talks, talks about how Vilna's cultural authority is something of a mystery, because it was never a demographic capital of Eastern European Jewry, never a political capital, never an economic capital in the way that perhaps Warsaw, Moscow, or, you know, over here, New York might have been. It was a provincial backwater. It was a border town, economically, and also quite impoverished, and cut off in the interwar period not only from the Soviet Union, but also from independent Lithuania. Demographically, Vilna's Jews in the interwar period, that's the 1920s and 30s, constituted a little less than 30% of its population, about 55,000 Jews. While Warsaw, with its 300,000 Jews on the eve of World War II, was almost six times the size. Vilna never had the same concentration of writers that other great cities did. It didn't have New York's Second Avenue, or Warsaw's Jung Theater, or Moscow's Gazette. It didn't have the circulation of the Vorwärts, or Warsaw's Haint. So there were richer Jewish cities, and there were larger Jewish cities, and there were bigger Jewish cities. But when the director of YIVO, Max Weinreich, was asked why he chose to establish the Yiddish Wissenschaftliche Institut, YIVO, in Vilna and not in Warsaw, and to move it, have it move from Berlin, where it was initially established, to Vilna, he didn't pause in explaining why it could not have taken root anywhere else. Quote, "Vilna has one thing that no other city in the world has. In Vilna, Jewish tradition and the Jewish present coexist." Listen, the Jewish tradition and the Jewish present coexist. What he means is they coexist and they respect one another. They're not of two camps. And then he goes on, "Only from these two elements can a Jewish future be built. Tradition is critical. Culture is not built with money or workers or good intentions or even talent alone. There must also be genius of place." It's a great line. I don't even know what it means. But I every time I speak, I try to. No, but I think of that. Like how does a place, obviously, a city cannot have genius? It's the people who live in that. But this idea of genius of place, we're sort of getting somewhere. Because when you think of Nusach Vilna and tie it together to genius of place, what was Vilna's genius then? And since when does a place have genius? So according to Weinreich, genius of place requires a collective appreciation, really a respect, a self-dignity for local history, and a constant force of reinvention. So these two things have to exist together, that you respect your past, you respect your elders, you respect traditions, even religious traditions, and even when you come into modernity, you respect those, even as you're rebelling against them. So something like the idea of having a deep or a thick usable past. But at the same time, it also needs to be something that's in constantly dynamic, constantly being reinvented. And that's why, though Vilna was smaller than Łódź or Warsaw, neither of them possessed yichus, right? Warsaw and Łódź, for all of their great number of Jews in Warsaw, and for all of its industrial power in Łódź, had no traditional yichus. Vilna had traditional yichus. So there you have the foundation of your traditional element. And then on the other hand, Krakow and Lviv had Vilna's history. They did have yichus, but secular Yiddish culture there was relatively thin. they didn't develop the same secular Yiddish institutions that Vilna did. So only Vilna, of all of those cities that we're talking about, at least in interwar Poland, had the combination of traditional religious Yichus and contemporary, we might even say radical, Yiddish culture. So part of that genius of place is part of Vilna's pseudonym, right? Yerushalayim Delite, the Jerusalem of Lithuania. The name itself has weight. A center, not only a center of religious learning, but whenever you use the term Jerusalem, and I know that Jerusalem's been in the news recently, but it also means political status or national status. So the idea that this is the Jerusalem of Lithuania means that it's not only a center of religious status, but also a center of national status, a center to which people make pilgrimage. People look to Vilna for direction. And although at earlier moments in Jewish history, there had been other diasporic Jerusalems, right? There had been Pumbetita as Yerushalayim de Bavel, Toledo as Yerushalayim de Sfarad. Those predated the times of an international Jewish press. Warsaw never became Yerushalayim de Polin. You know, you think, have you ever heard of anyone calling Warsaw Yerushalayim de Polin? So it didn't have the same status as Vilna. Now, part of that, of course, came through its scholarship, and we're not going to spend all our time today talking about it, but the iconic status of in the person of the Vilna Gaon was something that perhaps we still can't understand today. We know from those who were both communists and Zionists in the late 1930s, that is, who were very, very far away from the world of misnagdism and Torah scholarship that the Gaon had represented centuries earlier. They still respected the Gaon. None other than Abba Kovner, one of the fighters in the Vilna ghetto, said that there wasn't a single home in Vilna. Now he might be exaggerating, but okay, many homes in Vilna which was not touched by something of the Gaon's spirit. So it's not my purpose today to spend a lot of time on Vilna's position in the late 18th and 19th centuries as a traditional center of Torah scholarship, but I think that we need to recognize that not only is it a bastion of misnagdic Torah culture, but also of publishing. When we think of the Rome Press, of the writers Isaac Baer Levinson, of Mordechai Gunzberg, of Samuel Joseph Fuhn, of Avram Mapu, of Yalag, of Adama Cohen, of Kalman Shulman, of Isaac Meir Dick, of Avraham Uri Kovner, the founders of modern Yiddish and in some cases Russian Jewish literature, many of them circulate and move through Vilna. Vilna, of course, then also becomes a center of secular Yiddish culture. It's not only the founding site of the Bund in 1897, it's not only Hirsch Leckert, martyred in 1902, for shooting Vilna's Russian governor, but it also becomes the major center, or a major center, for the distributor for the publication of new Hebrew and Yiddish texts. After the failed revolution of 1905, the city becomes a center for Hebrew and Yiddish literature. There's a Zionist daily already in Vilna in 1906. The city attracts writers from elsewhere, including Shmuel Niger, who would have come on to America and become one of the great literary scholars of Yiddish, and Zalman Raisin. In 1908, the first Yiddish journal published anywhere is published in Vilna, Literarische Monatschriften. Grinicke Bemelech, starting in 1914, becomes a Yiddish journal for children. The reputation of the Vilna Truppe is made through the name of Vilna and the performance of the play of Anski's Dybbuk. After World War I, the school network, the Yiddish school network, becomes the pride of the city. Five daily Yiddish newspapers, Yiddish theater, Yiddish scouting, Yiddish sports, Yiddish choirs. The same year that the Zionists in Jerusalem established the Hebrew University, that's the same year that the Yiddishists established YIVO, eventually making its headquarters in Vilna. All of this is not to say that in the interwar period there weren't religious Jews and Zionists and Yiddishists who fought tooth and nail for their own beliefs. But it is to say that what united them all in that interwar period, no matter their political disposition, was a sense of civic pride, a sense of being someone from Vilna. Even years after Kulbach left Vilna for the Soviet Union, he wrote that I will always remain a Vilner. Right? So this is someone who ties his legacy to the revolution and is eventually consumed by the revolution. But he never forgets that he comes from Vilna, and he says, I'll always be from Vilna, no matter where my travels take me. So why Yiddish? Why did Yiddish have this status in Vilna? Why was it young in Vilna when it wasn't perhaps like that elsewhere? Well, perhaps because assimilation was more difficult in Vilna. And en bourgeoisement was a little bit more difficult in Vilna because of lack of capital. Vilna didn't have to, you didn't have to rise through the ranks. You didn't have to Polonize in Vilna in the same way that you had to Polonize in Warsaw or Russify in other places in order to become modern. You could become modern, you could be modern in Yiddish in Vilna. And part of the genius of that place is the fact that there was no majority group into which Vilna Jews could assimilate. In Warsaw, the majority of the population were Polish speakers, right? So if you wanted to assimilate into Europe, you switched to Polish. But if you're in Vilna, where a third of people speak Yiddish, and a third of people speak Polish, and a third of people speak Lithuanian, then you have no majority culture into which to assimilate. So keeping your own language then becomes far easier and perhaps even becomes the source of your own inspiration. And Kulbach himself, the great, really my favorite poet. I keep coming back to Kulbach the older I get, and I keep quoting him to my students, and I love his lines about the revolutionary city. And I think in Tel Aviv we talked this summer about his famous lines, "Lo mir gehen, lo mir gehen, lo mir doi berlosen die Schwache." Let us go, let us go, let us leave the weak ones behind. This idea of sort of looking ahead, moving ahead, not looking backwards, total faith, no matter where it takes you, and it took him to pretty dire places. But nonetheless, when Kulbach takes his students from Vilna to Warsaw, from the Yiddish schools that he's teaching in, he tells them before they perform Shakespeare in Yiddish and go on stage in Warsaw, go show Warsaw Jews what Vilna is all about. It's that type of sort of sense of oneself, of one's place, that's so attractive. Now, if you want to read a good chapter on genius of place or sort of cultural geography, you could do far worse, you could do no better. I shouldn't say far worse. You could do no better than looking at Cecile Kuznets' book on YIVO, because she has a great chapter there on cultural geography and how the old part of Vilna with the sort of modern part of Vilna, with the working class section of Vilna, all come together in what might be called a triangle of desire to produce a sense of the past, a sense of the future, and a sense of everyday Jews. That also becomes part of this idea of Nusach Vilna and part of this idea of genius of place. Before we move on to some of these texts, I want to talk just a little bit about Vilna's tradition of Zamobicher and almanacs. There's a tremendous tradition dating back much before the period that I begin with of texts that collect the information about the city in an attempt to produce a popular narrative of its history, both in Hebrew by writers like Fuhn and his Kiria Ne'amana in 1860, looking at Vilna as a maskilic center, then Josef Klausner, Toldot Yisrael de Vilna. Vilna published its own Yiddish Zamobicher and almanacs. Several were produced in World War I and just before World War II. We can think of Vilner Zamobuch, 1916 to 1918. 1922, Pinkes Friedrich Geschichte von Vilna. 1935, Vilna, a Zamobuch dedicated to the city. And Vilna Almanach, 1939. So think of this. How many almanacs has Toronto produced in a 30-year period about the history of the Jews of Toronto that are thick, that are rich, that aren't sort of fundraising things, but like are actually looking at the major contributions to world Jewish culture that a particular community has made? And if you really want to look at a great text, look at Zalman Schick's Toisent Jor Vilna, 1,000 Years of Vilna, published in 1939. Only one edition came out. Reputedly, there was a second edition that was lost during the war. And if you go to Vilna, take that along with you, if you're a Yiddish reader, and read the whole thing. It's unbelievable how detailed it is in saying, this is where all the synagogues are, these are where the churches are, this is where the Polish church was, and this is where the Lithuanian churches were, this is where the parks were. And you can actually see the love that he has for this place. So if we move to Vilna in modern Jewish poetry, there was an explosion of writing, what I've been trying to suggest, dedicated to Vilna or about Vilna in the interwar period. More than 24 poems about or dedicated to the city, just called Vilna or that have Vilna in the title. These begin already in World War I, but continue all the way through and even during World War II. But perhaps the most famous one that you have in the package is the one by Kulbach, Vilna, that ironically, of course, is published in 1926 in Warsaw. But, you know, more on that another time. This is an example of a very famous poem. So some of you might have read it, and if you haven't, I'm sure Anna will be happily read it with you in class. This neo-romantic poem legitimized the imagining and the reading of home as text. It encouraged the following generation of the writers I study, the writers of Jung Vilna, to take the idea of home seriously and to use that to as a challenge to communicate the problems and the complexities of their hometown. The influence of this poem could be measured not only by the influence it had at the moment in the 1926, 27, 28, but by the fact that it was republished by Zalman Sheikh when he came out with his Guide to Vilna in 1939, and then was the headline poem that was included when Avrom Sutzkever, who had been a member of Jung Vilna and who had known Kulbach, published an edition about Jung Vilna in 1981 in the greatest of all time Yiddish journal, Die Goldene Kate, that he published in Tel Aviv. So the poem comes out in three major publications at three different moments, we might say, in Yiddish literary history. And Kulbach's relationship with Vilna, of course, was vexed. I've just mentioned that. He writes to a friend from Berlin that, you know, he'll always be a Vilner. He tells people once he goes to the Soviet Union that he'll always be a Vilner, yet he doesn't remain a Vilner. And that's a topic for another occasion. But he does move back to the city in 1923, where he teaches. Can you imagine one of the great poets in any national literature choosing to teach high school students? But Kulbach says, if I'm a Yiddish writer, if I'm the Yiddish poet of my generation, then I need to create my own readership. And where am I going to create the readership? I'm not going to do it among the bolobosim. I have to do it among the students. I have to do it with young people. And he goes and teaches at the Real Gymnasia until 1928, when he leaves to be closer to his family in Minsk and says that he's going, you know, in Span, to, you know, in harness to join the revolution. We don't have time to look at all of these poems in great detail, but you have them in front of you and you can read them and discuss them later. I want to point out here that if we look at this first stanza of this poem, Vilna, someone in a talus is walking on your rooftops. Only he is stirring in the city by night. He listens. Old gray veins quicken, sound through courtyard and synagogue like a horse, a dusty heart. You are a psalm, spelled in clay and in iron. Each stone a prayer, a hymn every wall. So you have here in this first stanza a present tense composition between a speaker, really to a city. It's an ode from speaker to city, which signals that the poem is not a poem to a past. It's not a monument to something that no longer exists, but a claim on its present. But it's an interesting claim, to be sure. First of all, there's an overabundance of literary references, ranging from the literary to the secular, right? And even in this first stanza, he calls the city a psalm, a prayer, a hymn, gray writing, not necessarily the most enthusiastic image, right? Parchment and pages. I think all of these are meant to emphasize that the city is a text that is in, that he is inviting you to read. It's not simply to be inhabited. It's something that's meant to be textualized. And he doesn't say that you are like a psalm. He says you are a psalm. And that is also very different and something to think about. The fact that he says the city is a psalm of clay and iron. Think of those as substances, right? Clay is malleable. Iron is almost unbendable, right? This idea that you have something, that Vilna itself is both a fixed idea, it's something that exists, it has sort of status and classical heft, but it's also something that can be reworked. Clay is of the past, iron is of the present, right? Iron is something that's strong, it represents the Industrial Revolution. So you have both tradition and modernity mentioned in all of these, but notice that the dominant color is gray. And the dominant mood is funereal. And Anna remarked in her introductions about our time sort of 20-some years ago as graduate students, what I could never wrap my mind around were two things. One, Kulbach's grayness in this poem, and also the bleak, bleak condemnation that Bialik wrote about in his famous poem, Be'ir Hariga, right? When he talked about pogroms, sort of I was like, and people were saying these revolutionized, these mobilized the Jewish street. I'm like, mobilize the Jewish street? So depressing. This guy's writing about gray, and this guy's sort of berating the Jews for how they didn't come to their own self-defense and have no respect. How could anyone get motivated by that? And I think it has to do with sort of a cultural difference between what people find motivating in different places and in different times. So that is, you need to read this poem and realize that although Kulbach is mysterious and grim and funereal, another point he writes, only our sorrow is left. In our deafness, we hear lost cries. People didn't read this as something that they should give up on, but something that was the essence of their own experience and that they found inspirational. So you have at the first part of this poem a mood of loss, a mood of transgression, a mood of sin. You have the deep anxiety, perhaps, of the secular poetic voice, looking at everything that has been sort of given up for the sake of secularism. All those things that have sort of been washed away or sort of just flipped away with one's hand. But then you have this amazing shift in that dark mood. The shift begins in stanza 4. Right? We see the way the city is personified. He said it sprouts grass between the bricks of the ghetto walls, describing that as die Mauern mit Bärd, right? Bearded walls, almost personifying the city to look like some of its Jews. And the city is alive. Go back to Jung Vilna, right? Or to when Yiddish was young. Saplings blossom from the mortar. So out of the old comes new. A vision flows through the dreaming streets. And by the fifth part, you have a complete switch in the mood, right? By the end of that, you have this dramatic Whitman-esque concluding outburst, Ich bin das Gräu, ich bin der schwarze Flamm, ich bin die Stadt. I am that grayness, I am the black flame, I am the city. It underscores the degree to which Kulbach himself, or at least his speaker, reflected the richness and celebrated the contradictory commitments contained within himself. We are in a binary moment. Right? I think the Jews of Vilna understood and appreciated contradiction a lot more than perhaps our generation or our moment can. He, the speaker, becomes the city at the moment that he realizes that his fate is to be its messenger. If at the beginning of the poem, remember, Jerusalem of Lithuania, he references the lone person standing on the walls and referencing the Tzofet Yisrael, right? Person on the walls of Jerusalem itself. Here, the secular Yiddish poet becomes the speaker. He becomes the one. The future of the city is now dependent on its poets, on its chroniclers. The city and its chroniclers and its speakers and its poets and its cultural activists and its Yiddishists merge. So you have here in this single text elements of ambivalence, of doubt, of darkness, the contradictions and tensions of old and new, of decay and renewal. It even has some of the elements of a traditional kina, right? A poem of mourning. Nonetheless, despite all these things, the poet claims the city as the core, as the essence, as the basis of his creative soul for the future of secular Yiddish culture. So what is curious here is the degree to which the poem does not attempt to craft a recognizable Vilna topography like older poems did, right? He's not talking about streets or lampposts or hills. It sets out to craft a vision of Vilna, once again, almost as an entirely Jewish city. Would you know by reading this poem that there are other people who live there? It's a claim for the future made by the present and by the past. He transformed Vilna into a substantive text. So that by the time Jung Vilna arises in 1929, groups of writers and poets who are in their late teens or early 20s, the two most famous of whom some of you may have heard of, I've mentioned one is Sutzkever, the greatest poet, perhaps, of the latter part of the 20th century, and Grade, the greatest novelist, some might say, of the latter half of the 20th century, although Grade himself begins as a poet, and his first books, several books, are volumes of poetry. But there were many others in the group whose lives were cut short and whose names aren't as famous, including one who made it to Toronto eventually, Peretz Meransky. They capitalize on Vilna's reputation. They capitalize on Kulbach's message. They capitalize on what Zalman Raisin, the editor of the Vilna Tug, says, that Jung Vilna is the address for contemporary Yiddish enactments of Nusach Vilna. They take up the challenge. And the artists of Jung Vilna take up the challenge, but do so in a different way. And that brings me to this other text that follows, a poem by Lazar Wolff. Lazar Wolff is not a name that's well known in Yiddish literary circles, but he was, in his day, in this group, for sure the soul of Jung Vilna. He was its funny guy. He was its parody writer. He was the one who walked through the streets and tried to break the world record in poetry by writing 1,001 poems in 1 month. And one of his texts that he has here is called Vilner Schulhof, right? The Vilna Synagogue Courtyard. And look at how he writes this. This is the second example. I said that we were going to talk about neo-romantic poetry, expressionist poetry, call Kulbach's both perhaps. Now we have the parodic element intervening. Because here you have a reflection of a different mood, of a young generation overburdened by cultural inheritance and unimpressed that they inhabit a mythical cultural center. You know, at a certain point, if you're growing up in a city and everyone keeps telling you from outside the city, or even your own teachers, or even your own institutional leaders, you know, you should be so proud that you live in Vilna. This is such a great city. You live in such a mythical place. Oh, you know, it's amazing that you're here. At a certain point, you're going to say, I have nothing to eat. I have no job prospects to speak of. Polish nationalism, anti-Semitism is on the march. I have to sit at the back of the room or on the side if I want to take courses at Vilna University. It's great to have a myth, but who wants to inhabit a myth? Who wants to build a life in a myth? So you have someone like Wolff pushing back, engaging, but also pushing back against that by writing a poem that invites us at the beginning to think of it sentimentally, right? Oh, here's another poem about the Vilna Synagogue courtyard, where the Gaon of Vilna's Klois was, where the great Vilna synagogue stood, where the Strashun Library was located. That's what the poem is going to be about. But when you actually start reading it, it's not like that at all. It's about parody, poverty, insanity, subversion of religious motifs. If Kulbach's poem points our vision upwards at the end, right? I am the dark flame, I am the city. This poem drags us down to the material reality of daily life in the 1930s. It resists and defies and celebrates in defying expectations of space that is the subject of its title. So if you look, we won't read all of it, but if you look at the way, this is an unpublished translation, so it's a little rough, and you're welcome to work at it on your own. But when he talks about the Vilna Synagogue courtyard, instead of mentioning some of the more famous landmarks there that I just mentioned, he doesn't really talk about the Gaon of Vilna's Klois. He doesn't really go into the Strashun Library. He doesn't talk about the Große Stadtschule or even the communal well, all mythical spaces. Instead, he talks about the artist's Klois, that is the space where poets and writers, and especially visual artists, would go and look at what images they're painting in their own Klois. Transgressive images. But in the political context of Poland in the 1930s, the idea of painting a lion lying down with a lamb is exploded. In one context, it's a prophetic vision. But in an actual political context, really? Are we really supposed to believe in the 1930s that the lion is going to... Who would believe that anymore? And he loves pointing out these contradictions. And it all leads up to a joke, a description about how the space is carved up by this guild. And every different guild in Vilna has its own prayer space and study space, including a guild for those who suffer from hemorrhoids. Right? And the hemorrhoid sufferers have their own. So, you know, it's all about inflating the balloon and then deflating it with a thump, right? So you have this intense anti-clerical disposition in the poem. There's a lot of coded politics if one reads through this. At one point, he talks about Purim, the holiday of Purim, and the image of young boys pointing their fake pistols at the benign figures of blonde little girls, right? So non-Jewish girls on the Purim holiday. What's this all about? Other than saying that Purim becomes the opportunity in which Jewish culture allows itself to act out its own aggression. That any other time of the year, perhaps the only other time would be on Passover with the Shvach HaMoscha statement and the second half of the Haggadah. But other than that, Purim is the only time when these people can actually point the gun pretending that they actually have some agency to defend themselves against the accusations and the libels that are coming towards him. And despite the visual and metaphoric richness that you can peruse in this text, as he shows how the sea, how this one space changes in colors and shape through the seasons, it denies the reader the satisfying ecstasy, the Whitman-esque outburst or conclusion of Kulbach's Ich bin die Stadt. Rather, it ends on a very, very different note. Here, the Jewish water carrier is in his death throes. Here, the fire pot no longer glows. Here, the celestial mystic still dreams. Here, the last chassid dances in his tiny little room. So Wolff's rewriting of Kulbach's earlier text really pinpoints the painful mortality of Vilna for all to see. And it's not only Wolff. If you go and read the amazing memoir by Lucy Davidovich from that time and place, she talks about being a graduate student in Vilna in 1938-39 and studying with people I could only, I mean, I had great teachers, but people who I could only dream of studying with, studying along under the tutelage of Max Weinreich at the YIVO. But she says that even after that year of studying in Vilna, she felt that Yiddish had nothing left to stand on, that all of its fantasies were built on a myth constructed on sand, that those sands were shifting much more rapidly than people could actually even appreciate at the time. So you have all of these writers trying to continue to engage with the idea of place and space, but also engage with the challenges of their moment. Another unknown name in Yiddish circles. I'll give you some unknown names because we always talk about the greats. Shimshon Khan. Let me tell you a bit about Shimshon Khan, who no one really writes about, but why not? Seasoned member of Vilna's intellectual and cultural scene, totally dandyish, walking through the streets of Vilna. He brought the flamboyance of a dandy. He had a pale, gentle face with a long hairlock that he would love to run his fingers through. He paraded around town in fancy Russian shirts done up at the neck with a red scarf and tall, shiny black boots. And at a certain point, he moves out to the countryside and falls in love with what in those days was known as a gypsy girl, right? And before the war, he publishes an entire volume. Sadly, it's all lost, but we know that it was coming out for publication, of Yiddish Gypsyana. There's a whole volume of poems in Yiddish about gypsies. And he falls in love with a young gypsy girl. And in fact, he's devastated when the chieftain of that gypsy band says that she has to come back to live with her clan. He's welcome to come with her. And if she doesn't come back, she's going to be expelled. So she eventually leaves him, and it breaks his heart. But he also writes about Vilna. But he writes about it in a different way, in a completely unexpected way, by writing about not the Jewish population, but the non-Jewish population that had been previously excised from Yiddish texts that were trying to construct the cultural myth of place, and doing so in ways that perhaps are very, very unexpected. He talks about, in one poem, my grandfather, the wealthy innkeeper from Ravdonke, who causes me the most sorrow. Whenever one of your young girls came to him lost, meaning a gypsy girl came to knock on the door, he would drag her directly to the stack of hay in the barn and muffle her screams with his black beard. They did not know then that I had forged a bloody and honest vow. For every drop of blood consumed by grandfather, that hard, strict, and lustful Jew, I would provide them with an honest Yiddish poem. Constructs an entire career of atonement, sort of atoning for the sins of the grandfather by dedicating his career to Yiddish and building bridges with gypsy communities. That is, trying to build a multicultural Yiddish reality that represents the reality that's around them. I want to move in the final few minutes that I have, because I know that we want to leave time for questions, to Avrom Sutzkever. Because many, those of us who have written, there's a new volume of Sutzkever translations that just came out by Heather Valencia, but it's not really, you can't find it in places. But if you go on a German Amazon website, you can get it. But traditionally, I know, traditionally we've depended on Barbara and Benjamin Harshov's translations of Sutskever, right? But now we have one by Heather Valencia, and by the end of next year we'll have a new one by Richard Fine. So we will have three sort of selected poems, Yiddish on one side, English on the other side of Sutskever, that I think is going to take the field of studying Sutskever's poetry in dramatic new directions. And Sutskever was often accused of ignoring social realities, right? He was the type of poet where everyone else was writing about material realities or political realities, or were communists, or were engaged in some way. And Sutskever was writing about trees and flowers. His first big cycle was about snow and his childhood. And his friends didn't have a lot of patience for him. Katja Ginsky, you know, famously said, Sutskever mir seinen, mir leben in a Zeit von Stahl und nicht kein Kristall. We're living in a time of steel and not crystal. You're writing these amazingly well-constructed Yiddish poems. For who? For what? Sutskever, in his mind, knew for what? For Yiddish. For culture. That's for what? For something that transcends the immediate reality of the time. But Sutskever, by the time he finds himself in the Vilna ghetto, has already established a tremendous local reputation and sees himself, or comes to see himself as responsible for also carrying on the torch of his teachers, for also carrying on the heritage of a Max Weinreich or of a Moishe Kulbach who were no longer there. And in wartime, the fate of the city becomes a metaphor for the fate of its population. And that's where you have the beginning of a whole series of what we might call Vilna threnodies, right? Songs of lamentation for the dead. This is the greatest irony of all, because Sutskever was the aesthete. He made his reputation as a poet of nature. He wasn't interested in being a social poet or an urban poet, yet he emerged as his city's greatest voice in its final hour. And I bring as that example, there are many that I could point to, this unbelievable poem, Farewell, in the Harshov translation here. Published in 1943-44, and look at that opening line. Oh, not to mourn for you, I come, my city of song, or city of my song. That is, the city is destroyed around him, but he says, the easy thing would be to come and write a poem of mourning. I'm going to do the opposite. I'm going to write the poem amid mourning that celebrates you in such a way that you are still alive in poetry. I will freeze you in the imagination so that you will always be alive. And again, the return to the same spaces, the return to the Schulhof, a desire to incorporate the past life of the city into him. Look at how he writes. Listen to these lines. I want to enter you. He's talking about the city itself. I want to enter you like a night with glowing stars, to shine in every house, standing or destroyed, into faces living or not. For me, they live. For as the person feels his arm just now chopped off and sees the golden ring on his severed finger, so I feel the link with houses and friends. This becomes Sutskever's trademark. It had always been his trademark, but he solidifies it at the hour of greatest darkness, to be the poet of life, not to allow Yiddish to become the language of death or the language of the past. So that by the time you get to the second part of that poem, some of the favorite lines that I have, and I think they could be uttered not only to Vilna, but to anyone that you love. You are my first love, and my first love you will remain. He's talking to Vilna. I will bear your name throughout the world as my ancestors bore the holy ark on their shoulders, and everywhere I walk, all the cities will transform into your image. I think of Sutskever living, you know, decades in Tel Aviv, and I think of these lines, that sort of walking the streets of Tel Aviv and constructing a whole second career for himself there, but thinking of him walking through the streets of Vilna, the streets of Tel Aviv, saying that all the cities will transform into your image. And I will not strike roots anywhere else in any other soil. Right? I will not strike roots anywhere else in any other soil. So like in Kulbach that we saw earlier, the poet speaker near the end of this poem becomes the embodiment of the city. And it might be even more ecstatic in some ways than Kulbach's ending, because by the time one gets to read section 4, He writes, I am the child that carries the grass when they led him to slaughter. I am the woman hiding in the sewers with her newborn babe. I am the old man. I am the boy. I am the last word of one fallen into a pit. I am the man returning from the city with gunpowder in his boots. I am the already burned. But with the streams of the Velia, city's river, swims to you my song. Here, the individual poet becomes the collective voice of an entire civilization, but not until he condemns the perpetrators and bystanders to madness. And this is where the genius of the poem is even better. I mean, it's unbelievable the way that one of the courses that I teach, not every year, but every 3 years at Smith, is a course on Holocaust literature. And being someone who works on Yiddish, students think they're going to get a course on Holocaust literature, but what they really get is a course on Yiddish and Holocaust literature, which in some ways decenters and displaces all the well-known Holocaust writers that they've come to know from their studies. But he understood in 1943, 1944, sort of the way that people forget so quickly, how people are able to move on, because when you need to rebuild life, you can forget. And in that stanza five, he talks directly, a speaker talks directly to those people who will now move in and claim homes that Jews had been expelled from, right? Or had fled from. And he writes directly to them, he who thinks that his house is empty and walks in and picks up an idol, and puts up an idol, makes a bed, puts on an abandoned shirt or a dress or a shawl. At night he will hear the crying of children, and the shirt will become like a grater, shredding his skin, until he runs madly out of the house as if his conscience turned into a crow, went back into his brain, and he will run, and even his own shadow will not be able to keep up with him. So by the end of that, he's been able to become the voice of an entire civilization, leave Vilna, which he will do soon thereafter, while condemning those who sort of remain there for not having done enough to help the Jews, and end in that final section, section six, with a link back to the idea of Jerusalem of myth and Jerusalem of Lithuania, right? He already has a premonition of the culture of memory that will arise in Jewish life, and from the whole world, right? Think about sort of Jewish heritage tourism nowadays and sort of trips to Eastern Europe. From the whole world, pilgrims will come to your gold-stripped temple, and everyone will dip into your heart for a handful of ash. Everyone will dip into your heart for a handful of ash. But I who grew up in the shadow of your splendor, I will carry you whole, a bloody scroll. So you have this secular Yiddish poet turning back to Kulbach and talking about the city using a text that's normally thought of, at least in Jewish contexts, in religious terms. It's a sacralization of the city. And it's a way that allows the city to remain whole rather than bifurcated and cut up into small little pieces. And that's how he's able to sort of say goodbye. But this poem that is farewell, I would argue is also a poem of homecoming. Whenever I read this poem, it's a poem of return. It's not necessarily a poem of farewell. And one could talk about that also in the way he writes about Poland in his amazing poem, Pauline. But that for another lecture. So I think I've gone over by about 7 or 8 minutes, and I want to give all of you a chance to ask some questions and to make it home before the snow. And thank you for the invitation to come to Toronto.